Imagine bringing together the greatest investors of our age. People like Stan Druckenmiller, Ray Dalio of Bridgewater, Larry Fink of BlackRock, real estate investor Sam Zell, Seth Klarman of Baupost, and over a dozen others. And imagine you had only one question that you could ask. What would it be? Well, that's exactly what one of the world's most successful private equity investors has done. He's brought all of these investors together and asked them that one question, how to invest. And he's put their answers into an excellent book called How to Invest, Masters of the Craft. The author is David Rubenstein. David, of course, is the co-founder of the Carlyle Group, and he joins us today for a very special edition of Global Macro Update. David, thanks so much for joining us. There are a few themes, pretty dominant themes, I would say, that ran through your book when I was reading it. And that's really what I want to speak with you about today is just these themes. What do they mean to you and what should they mean to investors? And okay. The first theme is luck, ironically. That seemed to be a pretty dominant theme. And even with you early in your career, going into private equity, it seemed like there was a little bit of luck associated with that. How much luck is there really involved in investing?
Well, I think there's an enormous amount of luck in life, and there's obviously luck in investments. But I do believe you can make your own luck. In other words, if you sit in your room all day, you don't meet anybody, you don't hear of any opportunities, you don't read anything new, you're not going to get luck. In my case, when I started Carlyle, I started it because I'd met some people by happenstance, by luck, and I had them join my firm. It was complete happenstance. I happened to decide to get into private equity by luck, in effect, by meeting some people that encouraged me to do something like this, but it was luck. Now, you can call it luck, and it's just coming in from the sky somehow, but actually, when you think back on it, most luck, as we call it, is really, I think, produced by contacts you've met, or by being willing to open yourself to opportunities that might present themselves. If you say, I'm never going to consider a new opportunity, I'm never going to meet new people, you're probably not going to have any luck.
Makes sense. So Carlyle, you wrote in the book that the Carlyle Group generated for a long time an internal rate of return or annual return of about 25%, if not higher, which is pretty outstanding and right up there with all the other great investors that you've covered in this book. Can that be duplicated today, or was the early days of Carlyle and the Druckenmillers, the Jim Simons, were they all operating in sort of a perfect window for that type of return to be generated?
Well, that type of return was a, quote, gross internal rate of return. Obviously, the net is somewhat less, maybe 20% less. And that was in our corporate private equity area, which is our strongest area. Clearly, returns in real estate or international emerging market investments would be probably a little more challenging to get to that level over a sustained period of time. On the individuals you've talked about, a lot of them have specialties that make them the leaders in that area. So let's say Bruce Karsh in the distressed debt. Stan Druckenmiller, I wouldn't say is a specialist in any one thing, but has sustained those very high rates of return. We don't know what his returns are lately, but when he was managing money for other people, he had very, very high rates of return. I think generally, year in, year out, some people perform extremely well in the investment world. You have to assume it's not luck, that they have certain things going for them that make it possible for them to produce consistently outstanding rates of return, like Warren Buffett or Jim Simons or people like that.
One of the other themes that went through the book was adversity. Several investors that you spoke with suffered adversity, sometimes a major setback early in their career, and that seemed to set them up for later success. I'm curious if you ever had to deal with that, or maybe you had a close friend or associate who had some sort of a setback. And if you did, how did it impact how you approached investing later in your career?
Well, Carlyle had some setbacks in investments. Some of the early deals we did didn't work out. When we hardly had any money, we basically used it up in some deals that really didn't look like they were paying off. And so there was some adversity. What I try to say in the book is that any investor who's worth his or her salt has lost money, had some bad deals. If you basically put your head in the sand and say, I'm not really going to be able to do this, I can't survive, then you're not going to be able to really be a great investor. You have to take your losses, learn what you learned from them, and then move forward. And that's what we did at Carlyle. And I think all investors have had losses. If you've never lost any money in investing, you're really not investing.
Hold time was another one of the main themes that I picked up on. And it was, there's a lot of dispersion in hold time, but people like Ron Barron loves to buy a great company or back a great CEO and essentially hold that stock forever, sort of the Warren Buffett model, which is almost, unfortunately, you could almost say it's a little out of fashion these days in the you know, the meme stock kind of world that we seem to have just come out of post-COVID. How do you look at buy and hold today? Because it seems like buy and hold has changed, particularly in private equity. It sounds like holds are getting a little bit longer, even in an arena like private equity, where I always thought of as a 5 to 7 year hold, and then you have to sell or go public.
Well, the typical holding period in private equity has been 5 to 7 years. If after 7 years you haven't sold that company, there's probably a problem with the investment. Because whatever you're going to try to do to make the company better, you probably could have done it or should do it in 7 years, maybe even less. And we also know that investors like to recycle their own money in that period of time. So I think you can probably effectuate the change you want in 5 to 7 years, and investors are happy to get their money back in 5 to 7 years. Now, Carlyle has a long-dated program, as other private equity firms do, where you tell investors, look, we're going to hold on to this company for 10 years or more. And one of the reasons we'll do so is by not giving you the money back right away or in 5 or 7 years, we're going to still compound it at a very good rate. You won't have to worry about tax consequences, transaction costs, and so forth. Some investors who don't need the money back, sovereign wealth funds or very large public pension funds, who say, look, hold on to it for 10 years, because once you give me back the money in 4 or 5 years, I've got to figure out what to do with it anyway, and I might have an interim period of time where I'm getting virtually no return for that money. In my family investment vehicle, I have a family office. We can hold on for much longer periods of time because we don't have investors other than myself at this point who really are clamoring for the money back. I think generally, though, you're right in pointing out that people often like to get their money back quicker than 5 or 7 years. In the stock trading world, people tend to get their money back much more quickly. The advantage that Ron Barron and Warren Buffett have in their approach is that you eliminate two things by holding on for very long periods of time. One of them is transaction costs, the cost of buying a new company or selling a new company and so forth. And second, capital gains taxes. If you hold on for a longer period of time, you are likely to compound that amount of money at a reasonably good rate, but you're not going to be paying taxes, and you have a large amount of money to compound. So that's the advantage why I think Ron Barron and Warren Buffett have done pretty well. They're smart people too, but by not transacting a lot, they've avoided taxes and avoiding transaction costs.
Let's talk a little bit about risk management, if you don't mind. I thought Sam Zell said a great line to you when he said that one of the things that he does in his due diligence process is asks what could go wrong. Which I think is, kind of flipping the analysis on the head a little bit. Did that factor into how your team analyzed businesses, and what were some of the key takeaways in your book, How to Invest, that you learned from others about risk management?
Well, every deal looks wonderful at an investment committee, and every deal looks wonderful to the person who is putting it together. But in any investment committee, you have to say, all right, what can go wrong? Things don't always go the way you want them to go. And then in any investment committee that I've been participating in over the 35 years or so at Carlyle, we always assess what can go wrong. But sometimes things go wrong that you never anticipated. Who anticipated the war in Ukraine? Suppose you were looking at an energy investment in the renewable area, and carbon energy prices, you would say, are not going to go skyrocketing. Because renewable energy does better when carbon energy prices aren't that high, because it looks more attractive. But when carbon energy prices are high, it makes it harder to make renewables work quite the way you want them to work, and in terms of justifying the expenditure. So I would say if you had anticipated the war in Ukraine, you might have made a different decision. If you didn't know about the war in Ukraine, it's one thing. If you knew about it, you might have made a different decision. You can't anticipate all downside scenarios. It's just impossible.
There's a chapter in the book, David, about cryptocurrencies with Michael Novogratz. And he's an investor who it sounds like is going to take a very, very steep loss as a result of the FTX exchange and Alameda Research both declaring bankruptcy. The founder of that company, he really fooled a lot of people. This is one of those situations where we don't know yet if it will be fraud. It doesn't sound good, the news that we're hearing out of the bankruptcy court. But I also look at it and I think here's an industry that has a lot of promise, cryptocurrencies, and yet it's very, very unregulated. And it was a situation where you take a handful of young, relatively inexperienced individuals, 20s and low 30s for age, and then they're playing with literally billions of dollars of individual and investors, their funds. What could go wrong, right? In hindsight, you look at that and think this is a recipe for disaster. Any sense as to what might need to happen in that space, in the cryptocurrency space, to bring it out of what is a major, major setback and start to unleash some of the real potential in that space?
Yes, I would say that I did interview on one of my shows, Sam Bankman-Fried. He had an endearing kind of quality to him in the sense that he only wore shorts, T-shirt, and tennis shoes, and very unruly hair. Seemed to be an honest person who just wanted to do good. He was very interested in what's called effective altruism, and he seemed to have a lifestyle that didn't suggest he wanted to make lots of money or steal lots of money. We'll have to wait and see what actually happened there. But I think there is no doubt that the U.S. government, which is reluctant to move quickly to regulate cryptocurrencies, will move, I think, in the next Congress to do so. The debate, as you probably know, has been over whether the CFTC or the SEC should have the regulatory lead. I suspect now the SEC is probably going to take the regulatory lead because they're seen as being tougher on cryptocurrencies. Young people typically are the people that are often making the changes and the most dynamic leaders of the crypto industry. Is an industry that I have not invested in directly. I don't own any cryptocurrencies in my family office or through Carlyle, but I have invested in companies that service the industry. Fortunately, they're okay, and they seem to be fine at this point.
We're starting to hear some of those stories come around, but we're also hearing stories about some very, very sophisticated professional investors who did make multi-million dollar investments. Kind of stunning.
Yes. Well, Sequoia, which is maybe the leading venture firm of them all in the United States in recent years, and I did interview in my book Michael Moritz, who ran Sequoia for many years, they put money in the most recent round at FTX, and they've already announced that they're taking a complete write-off on it. And I think other well-known investors have put money into FTX. So every investor makes mistakes. Everyone gets fooled at times. And of course, when there's fraud, if there is fraud here, that's something that's harder to pick up in the due diligence, not impossible, but it's often harder to pick up.
This sort of ties in with, I mentioned experience, but also education. And this is an area that is personally very, I have a lot of passion around this topic of financial education, because it is my opinion that in the U.S., there really is no financial education unless you're going into finance or you're getting an MBA. You and I grew up with home ec, right? Home economics was taught in school. You were taught sort of the basics of how to manage money, what it means. At least it sort of puts you on a path that if you wanted to follow it, you could learn more about things like investing. Do you have an opinion on that?
Well, financial literacy for young people is not all that prevalent. And there aren't courses typically in high school that tell you what investments are about, how to manage your money, how to deal with all the issues associated with having money. You kind of learn it on the job or as you get money. I think we can do a much better job. I am amazed at how little is known about the investment world when I talk to some students who are in high school or college. So I do think we could do a much better job than we do. If you don't go to Wharton School of Business or an equivalent kind of place as an undergraduate, you're not likely to learn much about the investing world. I went to college and I didn't have any focus on business at the time, and I probably knew very little about money and the investment world.
You're in a unique position with Carlyle and with your family office. I'm sure you can attract the absolute best talent from business schools and finance schools in the world. But have you noticed a change? Is there the same flow of talent and the same level of talent coming out of the schools, the top level schools today? Or is it more difficult, are you finding, to access those people that can really move an entity forward?
I think there's a lot of very good talent coming out of the really, really good schools. And there's certainly the good business schools. I think as a general rule of thumb, investing is a place that people think they can make a fair amount of money. They can learn a trade. And it does attract very talented people, aggressive people, hardworking people. Of course, you know, their public policy, public service does attract good people as well. I think we have a pretty good group of people that we can attract in the investment world, because if you're good at it, you can make a fair amount of money. I can't say it's better or worse than it was 10 or 15 or 20 years ago, but there's no doubt that the wealth creation possibilities today in the investment world are staggering. Let me just give you an example. If you took the Forbes 400 when it was first created, I think in 1981, to be on the Forbes 400, you had to have a net worth of roughly $125 million. Today, probably you need a net worth of $2 billion. Now, that's illustrative of the fact that the amount of money available to be made is just so much greater than the rate of inflation over that period of time. And so there's no doubt that the income inequality we see, income disparity, is reflected in the investment world as well. You can make staggering sums at the top of this profession, and therefore it does attract a fairly talented group of people.
It does seem to me that investing in general is more important than it's been in decades, if not generations. There was a report, I think it was a couple of years ago, about how the average American couldn't afford a $500 unexpected expense, right? And we all know that Social Security is not necessarily going to provide a great level of retirement comfort. And yet, individual savings are, for retirement, quite low. Pensions are not as common as they used to be in companies, and people tend to bounce around more for work. It's just sort of the norm now. And this is a curveball question, so I acknowledge that. But just curious if you have any ideas on how to fix it, or what maybe even what the industry could do to help.
Well, we do have a problem in retirement for many people that are not in the investment world or haven't made large sums of money. There's no doubt that Social Security has not, in my view, really kept up with inflation, though there are so-called inflation adjustments with it. And there's no doubt that there are many people in the social and economic underclass in our country who are having a hard time getting by. And a big change has been the medical expenses are so much higher than they used to be. And as people are living longer, they're going to need more and more money for medical expenses. If you used to be, the life expectancy of the United States in 1900 was roughly, let's say, 60 maybe. And when the Social Security law was passed in 34, it was maybe 65. Today it's 80 something. And therefore, people are living longer and they need more medical treatment as they get older. But I don't know that Medicare and Medicaid and Social Security provide enough money for that. And therefore, a lot of people don't have the financial means to get all the health care treatment they probably need. So there are real challenges. And there's a real disparity. People in the private equity world who are doing things of the type that I'm doing are probably not as sensitive to this day to day as somebody like my parents. My parents were blue collar workers, and they were, you know, they lived more or less paycheck to paycheck, and they were always talking about not having enough money for this or not enough money for that. So it's a different world, and I imagine there are many people like my parents who are today suffering from the high cost of living, higher inflation, reduced impact of Social Security benefits.
David, just to bring this to a close, one of the things that I found really interesting in your book is How to Invest. It's an excellent book. I highly recommend it for anyone out there of any experience level, but especially if you're just thinking about getting into investing. Ray Dalio said something to you. It's one of his principles. He said, pain plus reflection equals progress. And for whatever reason, that really resonated with me. I had a very tough time in my career in 2008 and 9, and had to sort of rebuild from that. So I think that's why it resonated for me. I'm really curious, do you have one or two favorite quotes or favorite takeaways from your book?
Yes. When Jim Baker was in our firm, former Secretary of State, he always drilled into me what his father had drilled into him, which is prior preparation prevents poor performance. Or as Jim Baker would say, prior preparation prevents piss poor performance. And he was always prepared, and I try to be prepared as well. So if I'm doing an interview, I try to be prepared. If I'm making a speech, I try to be prepared. If I'm going to meet with people to try to raise money, I try to be prepared. I think preparation is really important, and people should not try to wing it as much as maybe I often see that they do. Prior preparation prevents poor performance, and people judge you on your performance. You can always say, well, I'm not that prepared, or I'm winging it, but I think while it might sound cute to do it, in the end, people will judge you if you're not prepared and you don't do a good job.
The book is How to Invest. The author is David Rubenstein. David, I always appreciate you taking some time to join us here at Malden Economics. Thank you so much.
Thank you. My pleasure. Thank you very much for having me.
Thank you for watching this week's Global Macro Update. Please take a moment to subscribe to our YouTube channel. I'm Ed D'Agostino. See you next week.